He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen, amen. Well, let's start together. Here we go. A sunny morning when this life is over.
Thank you. cannot wait for me to draw near to you. But you clothe yourself with frail humanity. You did not wait for me to cry out to you. But you let me hear your voice calling me. And I'm forever grateful to you. I'm forever grateful for the cross. I'm forever grateful to you that you came to seek and save the lost. You did not wait for me to draw near to you. And Merlin, if you want, you can come in and do the juice, okay? I want to read to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. Paul said, "For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.'" And we remember the body of Christ, and we know as we take the bread that it represents his body that was sacrificially given on our behalf. He took our place. It should have been us up there, amen? It should have been us. But it was part of the payment, and that's it was full payment, and that's what we remember. We remember that body that was given for us, Jesus, and we remember the stripes, and we remember the crown of thorns, and we remember the nails, and all the painful things that he went through so that we could know forgiveness and cleansing and healing and deliverance and eternal life. And they ate. Then the scripture goes on, Paul goes on to say, after the same manner also he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he come. When we drink the juice, we remember the blood of Christ that was shed for us on Calvary's cross. And every time we do the Lord's Supper, every time we drink the juice and eat the bread, we're proclaiming the reality of the fact that we believe he's coming back soon. Do you know, isn't it amazing to think about 2,000 years ago, Paul, in the very passage we're looking at, was talking about this because they were partaking of the Lord's Supper at that time too. And for 2,000 years now, every church, every house church, every church, the Lord's Supper has been ongoing for 2,000 plus years now, all in anticipation of the return of Jesus Christ. But I think, personally, I think we're living in that generation that will see the return of Jesus Christ. And I think Matthew 24 bears that out. And I think it could be any day now. That's why anytime now, I always say, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus because he could come at any moment. I know the scripture says when we least expect it, that's when he's going to return, when the world least expects it, you know. And I think we're kind of at a time and point in history where a lot of people are just saying, well, we've been saying that for over 2,000 years now, and, you know, he hasn't come yet. He's not going to come. It's not, you know, but when we least expect it, that's when he shows up. Amen? And it could be any day now. It really could. Although, I think that true Christians, true believers, aren't going to be caught off guard by it. We're going to be expecting it. I think true believers keep their eyes fixed on Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And that's why when the trumpet blares, we're going to hear it. We're going to sense it. So as we drink the juice, we remember the blood of Christ, which was shed for us. So the payment was made. And we give thanks for it. Do me a favor, grab your Bibles and sermon notes. If you want to fill in the blanks as we go. Hold up your Bibles. Here we go. Say, I believe.
I believe
that my Bible.
That my Bible
is the Word of God.
Is the Word of God.
I will love it.
I will love it.
I will learn it.
I will learn it.
And I will live it.
And I will live it
to the glory of God.
To the glory of God.
Amen. Amen. Let's have commitment to the Word. Let's go ahead and let's pray for today's message. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just pause once again to thank you for the teachings of your Holy Word. And Father, as we consider now this subject of Easter and does it really matter, we pray that in the process you just open our eyes and our ears and our hearts and our minds to the deeper truths that you would have for us today. Lord, use this message and messenger now as you see fit and do in every heart, Lord, what only you can do through the power of your Spirit. For we ask all this in Jesus' holy name, and all of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Some time ago, Newsweek magazine carried an article on the subject of heaven. And the article began with a reference to a passage of scripture that I have printed on your outline there. It's the first passage, John 11:25-26. Would you read that with me? Let's read that together out loud. Let's start that way. Let's read it together out loud. Ready? Here we go.
Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?
Amen. And the article goes on to say then, now as the gospel tells it, the women and men who stared at Jesus' temple tomb, or empty tomb, were not inclined to believe the good news. They were frightened, scattered, fearful that they had been misled. In fact, the apostles themselves were very slow to accept the idea of Christ's resurrection. And yet, just as Easter is the holiest day of the Christian year, so is the resurrection the deepest wellspring of Christian faith and hope. For if God can raise Jesus to everlasting life, mankind can also fully expect to dwell with him in heaven. And then Kenneth Woodward, who was the author of this particular Newsweek article, he put the importance of Easter in perfect perspective when he said this. He said, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the only hope we have of a future after death. Christ himself wrapped the two events up in one sentence when he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. End quote. And folks, it is the resurrection of Jesus Christ that really sets Christianity apart from all other religions.
Amen.
I mean, it is. It's our belief that what we celebrate at this season of the year is totally unique to Christianity. Easter is celebrated virtually all across our nation and around the world by people who believe in Jesus Christ and by people who don't. And yet, Easter is all about and just all encompassing about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is unique to Christianity. In fact, let me be clear about this. In fact, it's the next key thought on your outline there. The foundation of our faith is the well-established record of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is the foundation of our faith. The very foundation of our faith is the well-established record of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Listen, the foundation of our faith is not the teachings of Jesus Christ or the ideology that may have developed from his teachings. That they're great, they're wonderful, they're important. But that's not the foundation. The foundation of our faith is not the Christian worldview that we hold, although that's very important as well. The foundation of our faith is not the wonderful life of Jesus or the compassionate miracles that he performed. The foundation of our faith is not even the death of Jesus Christ. You know, all religious leaders of the world have died. They've all died. And so in that respect, Jesus Christ would be no different. Now, the foundation of our faith is the well-established record of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Christ said that he would die, and then in 3 days that he would come back from the grave. And folks, Jesus did exactly that. He did what he said he would do. Amen?
Amen.
And it was that very event that exploded into the hearts of the disciples and convinced them that this Jesus was who he claimed to be, that he was the Messiah, the very Son of God. Wilbur Smith wrote this. He said that Jesus said that he was going up to Jerusalem to die. It's not so remarkable. Though all the details about his death weeks and months before he died are together a prophetic phenomenon, but when Jesus said that he himself would rise again from the dead the third day after he was crucified, he said something that only a fool would dare say, unless he was sure, of course, it was going to happen. No founder of any world religion ever dared say anything like that. And that's the message of Easter, though, that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the unique message of the gospel that comes only from the scriptures, resident only in the Savior, the Son of the living God. Now, in this Easter message today that I want to share with you, I just want to suggest three reasons as to why the resurrection is central to all of us and why it's the most really important holy day of the year. Just three quick reasons. I wrote this heading on your outline there, three reasons why Easter matters to all of us. And the first reason is this. Number one, Easter matters to all of us because Easter matters to Jesus Christ. Amen? I mean, it matters to him. I mean, for a variety of reasons. Look at the next passage on your outline there, Luke 24:6-8. It says, "He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words." Now, I just want you to notice, and we'll talk about this in a little bit more a little bit later on, but I want you to notice he says, "crucified, and the third day," what?
Yes.
"He would rise again." He would rise again. So we see the crucifixion and the resurrection connected, right? We see them connected right there. Now, the first thing I want you to see, though, is letter A on your outline there. The resurrection of Jesus Christ really vindicates his word. It vindicates his word. Many times in the Bible, Jesus promised that after he had died and was buried, that in 3 days he would come out of the grave victorious over death. The fact that he said that well ahead of the time that he died is very evident because even his enemies had already heard of it, and they believed it. I mean, his enemies believed it. Even the enemies of Jesus had heard him say that he was going to come out of the grave in 3 days, and they not only heard it, but they believed it so much that they feared it. They were afraid of it. Look at the next verse on your outline there, Matthew 27:63-64. The Pharisees had gone to Pilate after Jesus' crucifixion. Here's what they said. They said, "Sir, we remember," this is what the Pharisees are saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how that deceiver," speaking of Jesus, they called him a deceiver, "how he said, 'After 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, 'He has risen from the dead.'" So the last deception will be worse than the first. I like it that they said after 3 days, you know. They were saying at least secure it for those 3 days. They didn't care if he rose from the dead on the fourth or the fifth, because they'd say, "Well, see, he didn't keep his word." I mean, that's what they would say. But seal it up for those 3 days. We want to make sure he does that. I mean, they were afraid. They were scared. I think we live in a world of people who hate God. They hate Christ, but they're scared to death of him. Mm-hmm. They are so scared of him. I think that's why Christianity is being more and more persecuted. It's because of the fear of Jesus Christ. The fear that he's really going to come back. The fear that he's really going to do what he said he was going to do. And that fear is growing. I tell you, that fear is... I think what should be happening in Christianity... I'm just going to throw this in there, but I think what should be happening in Christianity is that the fear of Christ's return ought to be growing while the fear of Satan ought to be diminishing. I think the fear that Christians may have about Satan or about what the world is trying to do or what the culture is trying to do, I think that ought to be diminishing within the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
I think our faith ought to be growing to the point that we're no longer afraid of that kind of stuff, but the fear of the world is growing too, so that they're becoming actually more violent as a result of their fear, which is what happened here. You know, those folks would say that Jesus Christ didn't really say that after 3 days he would come back from the grave alive. Those folks who say that, they have a major problem here, because even those who were hostile toward him believed that he said it, and they were afraid of. Folks, we have to remember that even up to this time, Jesus had always kept his word, right? He'd always kept his word, and so if he had not come out of the grave as he said he would do, then nothing else that he ever said could be believed either. He had to do it to vindicate himself, right? I mean, if the resurrection didn't happen as the Bible says it happened, then Jesus Christ is a fraud, and Christianity is just another meaningless religion, just like all the other religions around the world. Like, I'm just going to be honest with you. If it weren't for Christianity, I would have nothing to do with religion at all. Because I think they're all bogus, except for Christianity. And I've studied most of the religions of the world. And the only one that has any sense of validation to it is Christianity. And really, that's because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. So Jesus did come back from the grave exactly as he said he would do. And in so doing, he vindicated his word. But secondly, letter B on your outline, your Easter matters to Jesus Christ because the resurrection of Jesus Christ validates his work. he's vindicated by it, but it validates his work. I mean, when Jesus died on the cross, he paid the penalty for our sins in his body. But if he had not come back from the grave, then how would we ever know that his sacrifice was accepted as the final payment for our sins? The resurrection is God's guarantee of the validity of the accomplished work of Jesus Christ. In fact, here's the next key thought on your outline. The cross of Christ is the payment for our debt, and the resurrection is God's receipt for the payment in full. So the cross is the payment. The cross of Christ is the payment for our debt. That's what was demanded death. But the resurrection is God's receipt for the payment in full. In other words, that's God saying, I accept it. See, when Jesus came out of the grave on the third day, he demonstrated that what he promised he would do when he died on the cross, he indeed did. And it was true. Because if a person can overcome death in his own strength, that person must be God, must be the God that he claims to be. And folks, Jesus Christ is the God-man. Amen? He is the God-man. He's God in the flesh. And so the resurrection of Christ vindicates Christ's word. It validates Christ's work. And folks, that's why when the crucifixion is mentioned in other books of the New Testament, including the passage we just read a little bit earlier, you almost always find the resurrection mentioned right alongside the crucifixion. That's why I pointed it out when we first read it. There's the crucifixion, but you're almost always going to find right next to it the resurrection. If you just believe in the crucifixion of Christ, folks, that's not enough. By the way, you know why evangelical Christians don't carry a crucifix, right?
Because that's not the end.
Right. Yeah. Catholics carry a crucifix. In the Catholic Church, you'll see the cross with Jesus hanging on the cross. But in evangelical churches, Baptist churches, and any evangelical church, you're just going to see an empty cross. Why? Because Jesus didn't stay on the cross. Amen? He came out of the grave alive. He's alive today. We don't worship a Jesus on the cross. We worship a living Savior. Amen?
Amen.
That's why we worship a living Savior. If you just believe in the crucifixion of Christ, that's not enough, because the crucifixion of Christ does not set Jesus Christ apart from every other would-be religious leader and martyr throughout history. I mean, many human beings have died claiming to be something that they were not. But when Jesus died, claiming ahead of time that he would come back from the grave, and then he did exactly that, his resurrection is what sets him apart from all others as truly the Savior of the whole world. It sets him apart from every other person. Look at the next verse on your outline there, Romans 8:34. It says, it is Christ who died, and furthermore, is also what?
Risen.
Notice, crucified and what?
Risen.
Crucifixion, resurrection put together. So it's Christ who died and who is risen. And over again, you read that in the scriptures, that you're going to find those two connected. And they're going to appear to be one event, because they are. Amen? They are.
Amen.
It's the same Jesus. So the resurrection of Christ vindicates Christ's word. It validates his work. But then let her see, the resurrection of Jesus Christ also verifies his worth. It verifies his worth. If the crucifixion of Christ had ended it all, if that was it, if that's all that happened was his crucifixion, if Christ had gone to the cross as we celebrate on Good Friday and died the awful death that he died, he would certainly have been remembered for his miracles. He would have been remembered for his life. He would have been revered among those who knew him, and they would follow him as a good man and a righteous person, much like the women who went to embalm his body after his death, like Nicodemus, who helped to provide the myrrh for the embalming of his body, and Joseph, who had given Jesus his own sepulcher, remember that, gave him his own tomb. All of them would have remembered Jesus fondly and with love and with adoration. But when he came back from the grave, when he rose from the dead, bringing with him power over death and eternal life for all who would believe in him, he became much more than just a memory. Amen? He became much more than a memory. Because that's why, you know, when we took the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians, that's why Paul said, you do show forth the Lord's death till he what? Returns. So we're looking back, we're remembering, but at the same time, we're looking forward, because he's alive, he's coming back. Amen?
Amen.
We worship him for it, the sacrifice that he made for us. We thank him for that, and we remember that. But we're looking forward to his return every time we take the Lord's Supper. When he came back from the grave, bringing with him power over death, and eternal life for all who would believe, he became much more than just a memory. Because if the cross is all there is to Jesus, then he's a martyr. But if the resurrection is true, then he's not just the martyr, he's the master and our beloved Savior. It is the resurrection that verifies the eternal worth of Jesus Christ. So, the resurrection matters to Jesus Christ. Easter matters to Jesus Christ. Because according to 1 Corinthians, If there's no resurrection, if there's no, then there's no faith, and if there's no faith, then we're lost, right? I mean, if there's no resurrection, we're still in our sins, and if there's no resurrection, then Christianity is a hoax. But the amazing truth is, he's risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hey, they're going to try it again. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
There you go. So Easter matters to Jesus Christ. But that's not all, because if you haven't noticed, and here's number two on your outline, and secondly, Easter matters to the critics. It should matter to us, because Easter matters to the critics. Every year during the days that build up to Easter, some liberal atheist is going to deliver a book or a movie or an article or a story that's an attempt to destroy the faith of the followers of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And it's been like that for as long as I can remember, and I expect it to get even worse as the coming of the Lord's return gets even closer. There was a news article that was written with this as the title of the article. It said, "Attacks on the Church are Big Business During the Holy Days." And it is. It's big business. Because listen, if the resurrection of Jesus Christ is indeed the central truth of the gospel, then wouldn't it follow that the critics would try everything they could to destroy the truth of the resurrection? Of course they would. They're going to do everything they can to destroy the truth of the resurrection. Now listen, if there is a critic anywhere who can take you, who can take me, and they can take us to Palestine, to a tomb, where there is found the verified remains of Jesus Christ, then Christianity, frankly, is all but dead. Because at that very moment, the reality of the resurrection would be overturned and Christianity would be done. Because Christianity is built upon the truth of a living, risen Savior, not a dead one. But the critics continue to try every way they can to destroy the reality of the resurrection. Now, they don't worry so much about the crucifixion of Christ. I want you to understand that. I mean, you don't hear too much criticism about the crucifixion of Christ. There's no way to deny the crucifixion, right? I mean, the evidence and the reality and the historical truth and documents in relationship to the crucifixion of Christ is just so well done. There's no way you can deny that that's what happened. But they zero in on the resurrection because that's the supernatural evidence of the validity of our faith. Now, interestingly enough, none of the critics have ever argued that on the first Sunday after Christ's crucifixion that the tomb was empty. They've never argued about that the tomb was empty. Even the most hateful critics admit that the tomb was empty.
Yeah.
They'll admit that. But what they try to do is to explain away why it was empty. They come up with reasons why the tomb was empty. And just in case there might be somebody here today who thinks that it takes a great deal of faith to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, I want to take a few moments and show you how much more faith it takes to believe in what the critics say happened. All right? And so I thought you might be interested in their ideas down through the centuries that try to explain away the resurrection and why the tomb was empty. In fact, here's the next key thought on your outline. The critics' ideas of why the tomb is empty. And one of the more famous ideas is this. Here's letter A on your outline there. It's known as the wrong tomb theory. The wrong tomb theory. A critic by the name of Chrysop Lake explains how the resurrection happened in his point of view. According to Lake, here's how it happened. The women who report, now this is the premise of it all. He says, the women who reported the body missing had mistakenly gone to the wrong tomb.
Blame the women.
Blame the women. That's right. Blame the women. They went to the wrong tomb. Well, that's wonderful. I mean, in concept, except that if that's true, then the disciples, Peter and John and all the others who went to check up on the women's statement that the tomb was empty, they also went to the wrong tomb. And then here's a good one. The wrong tomb theory also assumes that the angels went to the wrong tomb. And the Achilles heel of that explanation is that the Jewish leaders who wanted very badly to disprove the resurrection would have lost no time in going to the right tomb to produce the body of Jesus Christ and shut down forever the rumor of a resurrection. But of course, you know that they didn't do that because they couldn't do that because it wasn't the wrong tomb that they went to. It was the right tomb that they went to. It was just an empty tomb. Amen?
Yeah.
Just an empty tomb. But then there's a theory that was made popular a few years ago from a book that was written called The Passover Plot. And a critic by the name of Venturini helped to promote this theory. And Venturini actually wrote about this hundreds of years before the book came out. And this theory says that Jesus didn't really die, that he just merely fainted from exhaustion. And he passed out from loss of blood. Everybody thought he was dead, but really he just swooned. And so that's letter B on your outline there. This is called the swoon theory. the swoon theory. Now, I bring these up to you, and I try to bring these up every couple of years. I talk about these every couple of years because I want Christians to understand what we're facing, what we're dealing with. But these are the most popular explanations as to why the tomb is empty. It's a swoon theory. And swoon theory says that Jesus just passed out. And then later on, while he was in the tomb, the coldness of his grave resuscitated him. And then he pretended to be resurrected. Now, here's what this theory is asking us to believe. That Jesus Christ somehow survived a six-hour crucifixion by professional soldiers who were skilled at putting men to death, as well as surviving a spear wound to his heart. That Jesus then endured the coldness of the tomb for 3 days after that, and that in his weakened condition, he removed not only his own grave clothes, but he also removed the huge boulder that covered the entrance to the grave. And then Jesus then convinced his disciples and hundreds of more people that he had a glorious resurrected body. Now, wait just a minute here. I mean, he appeared before to Mary on the third day in his glorious resurrected body. Mm-hmm. But wait a minute. He had just been crucified 3 days earlier. Do you know how long it takes to heal from the wounds of being whipped like that, having your flesh ripped from your body? Having those crown of thorns pierced your brow, having his face beaten, his beard pulled. I mean, do you know how long it would have taken for him to have healed that should he have survived the crucifixion itself? There was no way. They wouldn't even have recognized him on the basis of the beating that he took prior to his death. There would be no way. Folks, I'm telling you, the critics don't have a leg to stand on, and yet it's amazing as to how many people will want to believe stuff like this. There are a ton of people who believe this theory. They do. They go, no, he just passed out. He resuscitated, and he came out, and everybody just thought he was resurrected. That's what they said. If the resurrection, look, isn't true, then the claims of Christ upon us are of no value, right? I mean, that's why people want to believe this. Because if it's not true, then Jesus has no right to lay the claims that he does. But if the resurrection is true, then Jesus has every right to call every one of us to allegiance to him.
Amen.
Jesus has every right to tell us that we are perishing in our sins and that we need his forgiveness to be able to enter into heaven. If he resurrected from the grave, he has every right to do that. If you can do away with the resurrection, then that gives you an excuse to continue to live any way you want to live and be as immoral as you want to be, guilt-free. But you know, even if people choose to believe that kind of nonsense, here's the good news. Even if people want to believe this kind of nonsense, like the swoon theory, and reject the truth of the resurrection of Christ, they still can't escape the conviction of the Holy Spirit on their heart as well. They still can't escape the conviction of the Word of God. Amen? Amen. And what the Holy Spirit brings to that. So there's one last idea that some come up with that they try to deny the resurrection. Here's letter C on your outline. It's called the stolen body theory. The stolen body theory. A number of critics have suggested that the body of Jesus was stolen by the disciples while the Roman guards slept outside the tomb. Now, never mind that for a Roman guard to fall asleep outside the tomb meant his death. He would be put to death. So Roman guards would not fall asleep on duty. They just wouldn't do it. For one thing, the depression now and the cowardice of the disciples at this point in the story provides a rather convincing argument against these guys becoming then suddenly so brave as to go steal the body. All right, so, I mean, that's what they're saying. They're saying the disciples came, and while the guards slept, they stole the body. Well, these guys were, I'm just going to tell you, they were scaredy cats. All right, I mean, that's what they were. I mean, history teaches that the disciples all forsook Jesus, and they ran away. When Jesus was crucified, there was only one left standing at the foot of the cross, and that was John. All the others had run away. Now all of a sudden we see him becoming courageous just 3 days later and going to the tomb and trying to steal the body? I don't think so. These same disciples, now the truth is, later on, they suffered incredible cruelties and they suffered persecution and they were all put to death for their faith because they wouldn't stop preaching about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So the question is, do you think these disciples would have endured such hardship to themselves and their families if they knew in their hearts that the resurrection was a hoax, that they had actually stolen the body? Do you think they would go through all that for a lie, for a hoax? I don't think so. Listen, it wasn't the wrong tomb. Jesus didn't swoon, and nobody stole his body. He came out of the grave victorious over death in his own power, and he put his foot on the neck of death, and he gained victory for all of us over it. Amen. In the matter of life and death, folks, Jesus is our champion, and everybody
Amen.
Said,
Amen.
Amen, he is. And we can be sure that what he said would happen really did happen. He is risen. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Now, listen, Easter matters to Christ. Obviously, Easter matters to the critics. But then thirdly, number three, Easter matters to the Christian as well. Easter matters to the Christ, to the critics. Easter matters to Christ, to the critics, and to the Christian. Letter A, the resurrection of Christ prepares us for death. That's why it matters to us. The resurrection of Christ prepares us for death. See, whether we like it or not, we're all suffering from a terminable disease. And if Jesus' resurrection isn't true, then life is short, we die, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, if Jesus wasn't resurrected, then, look, I'm just going to be honest with you. Oh. This is all there is. What we experience here is it. It's over. We don't like to look at stuff like this, especially when we talk about death. We don't like looking at that, but the last time I checked, the statistics concerning humanity and death are still 100%. Nobody lives forever. Amen?
Amen.
In that sense of physical bodies that we have right now, nobody lives forever. Right? So that makes all of us candidates for the hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because we're all going to die. Amen?
Amen.
An old preacher was dying, so on his deathbed, he sent a message for a banker and a politician. That makes sense to me. Preacher's dying, is on his deathbed. He looks up and he sends. He's on his deathbed. He says, "I want that banker and I want that politician in my church. I want you to go get them." That when they arrived, they were ushered up to his bedroom. They went to his church. Occasionally, they were in his church, and they entered the room where he was at. The preacher held out his hands and motioned for them to sit on each side of his bed, one on his right hand, one on his left, And the preacher grasped their hands, and he sighed contentedly, and he smiled, and he just stared up at the ceiling. And for a time, nobody said anything. They just sat there with him holding their hands, and they just sat there. And now both the banker and the politician were touched and flattered that the preacher would ask them to be with him during his final moments. They were also a bit puzzled, though, because the preacher had never given them any indication that he particularly liked either one of them. They both remembered his many long and uncomfortable sermons about greed and about covetousness and about lying and about immoral behavior that made them squirm every time he preached on those things. Finally, the banker said, "Preacher, why did you ask us to come here today?" The old preacher mustered up his strength and then he said weakly, "Well, Jesus died between two thieves and that's how I want to go as well." I guess the point is, look, unless Jesus returns in our lifetime to rapture out the church, we all have an appointment with death, don't we?
Amen.
I mean, we all do. We all have to face the reality of death. And because Jesus came back from the dead, we no longer have to spend our lives fearing death or denying it. It is coming for everybody. Sooner or later, it comes for everybody unless Christ returns. We may not look forward to death, but we don't have to live our lives in fear of death, though. We just don't. Christ has overcome death, and he promises us victory over death as well. One day we're all going to die physically, and if the Lord's return is delayed, we're going to die, but it's a temporary death. As a matter of fact, Wednesday night we were talking about death a little bit, and I talked about people who have died who are Christians and stuff, and one of the things I've noticed is that when they die, as a Christian, maybe painful, there may be pain involved, but it's an easy passing. And really, death, when it comes to that moment of death, it's just a momentary thing. In fact, I'm not even sure, really, listen, I'm not even sure, really, that we even cease to die, that we cease to exist. I think it's just a smooth transition from this body to being with Jesus. I think this body gives up and we just exit and we go to be with Jesus or with him. We're all going to die physically, but we're not going to die spiritually. Amen? Remember what I said and I've been saying? We are a soul. That's who we are. We are a soul. Our soul doesn't end. Our soul was in existence before we got our physical body. We were in existence as a soul before our soul was conceived in that body in the womb of our mother. Our soul is not going to end when we die. It continues on. Who we are goes on. And one day our bodies are going to be resurrected, this physical body, and be reunited with our soul and spirit, and we shall live with the Lord forever if we put our trust in Him and in what He did, and we gain then victory over death just like He did. Amen?
Amen.
Eugene Peterson has a wonderful paraphrase of a section of Scripture in Romans chapter 6, and he puts this hope that I've been talking about kind of in modern terms in this particular version, and I want to read it to you as you listen. Here's what he said in Romans chapter 6. He said, "We stand in awe, not just because of what we see, but because of what we know. We know that we too will die. We know that we too will be buried. Our lungs, like His, will empty. Our hands, like His, will stiffen. But the rising of His body and the rolling of the stone give birth to a mighty belief. What we believe is this. If we get involved in Christ's sin-conquering death, we also get included in His life-saving resurrection. We know that when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was a signal of the end of death as an end. Never again will death have the last word. When Jesus died, He took sin down with Him, but alive, He brings God down to us." Romans 6, verses 5 and 9 in the Message Paraphrase Bible. Romans 6, 5 through 9. Folks, the resurrection of Christ is our hope. It's what we believe in our hearts. It's what gives us a sense of peace, even when we're going through times of stress. Because we know that what we experience here is not the final experience of all of life, but what we experience here, it's joys and it's sorrows, just a brief moment compared to eternity with God. Amen?
Amen.
I mean, an eternity which was purchased as a gift for us through the death of Christ and His resurrection from the grave. So not only does the resurrection prepare us for death, but here's letter B, the resurrection of Christ prepares us for a future hope as well. For a future hope. If you believe that Easter really happened 2,000 years ago, then Jesus really did come out of the grave victorious over death, then that's our guarantee of a future hope. Look at the next verse, 1 Corinthians 15, 16 through 18. Paul says, For if the dead don't rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep or died in Christ, they've perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most pitiable. Wow. See, Paul's making the point that you cannot have eternal life without the resurrection. That's the point. If Christ didn't come out of the grave victorious over death, then we have no hope for ourselves. But He did. Paul pins the hope of the believer squarely on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The great apostle Paul reminded the Thessalonians, for example, that yes, they sorrowed over death, but they didn't sorrow as those who have no hope. In fact, look at the next verse, 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Paul said, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning these and those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope." We who are Christians have hope. And when we lose hope, when we lose somebody in death, we don't lose hope because they die.
Amen?
Amen?
Yeah.
Because our hope is in a resurrected Savior. We sorrow, but it's not a despairing sorrow. It's not a sense of finality, of total loss, because we have the hope that because Jesus Christ came out of the grave and He was victorious over death, and He promises that if we believe in Him, that we too are going to be raised out of the grave one day, that on that day, we're going to be reunited with all our loved ones who have gone on before us, who also have believed in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That's why when I die, it's going to be a party, because I'm going to get to see my mom, I'm going to see my grandma, I'm going to see my grandpa, I'm going to see all my brothers and sisters in Christ who died in the church before me. I mean, we're going to get to see them all. We're going to get that. Boy, you talk about an incredible fellowship, amen?
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to be rich there in that. It's going to be just overflowing with fellowship. Folks, that's our hope of the resurrection. So the resurrection of Christ prepares us for death, and the resurrection of Christ prepares us for a future hope. But it gets even better than that. Here's letter C. The resurrection of Christ prepares us for a future home as well. It prepares us for a future home. Look at the next verse on your outline there, John 14, 1 through 3. And this is one passage I would just encourage you to memorize. This is one of the best passages to memorize. It's just listen to what Jesus said. He said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And everybody said,
Amen.
You know, that's a wonderful passage to memorize, and I encourage you to memorize it, because if someday you're on your deathbed, I can promise you this is a passage that will be going over in my mind over and over and over again. I'll be thinking of this passage right here in my mind over and over again. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, but I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I'm coming again to get you, so that where I'm at, you may be also. Amen? That's going to be, I know what's going to be happening in my mind. I've faced the possibility of death a few times, and I've got to tell you, since I memorized that, that's what I think about. That's a promise I hang on to. That's a hope that I have. The belief in heaven is an intuitive belief that God has put within each person that he's created. Did you know that? Let me say that again. I want you to get this. Listen. The belief in heaven is an intuitive belief that God put in the heart of every single person. Every person intuitively believes that there is life after death. An article in Time magazine once featured this question in bold type. The question was, does heaven exist? And after discussing in detail the fact that the concept of heaven had fallen onto hard times in recent years, the article reported a survey that was taken where this question was asked of people saved and unsaved. And the question was, do you believe in the existence of heaven where people live forever with God after they die? 81% of the people who were asked that question said they believed in such a place. 81%. 88% said that they would meet friends and family members who have already died in heaven again. Folks, the intuitive belief, listen, that intuitive belief is given to us as a gift from God. However, it's not activated until we put our trust in Jesus Christ and in what he's done.
Amen.
We all believe that this is not all there is, that there is life after death. I mean, we struggle sometimes with the fact that, oh man, there are times, and you tell me if you haven't thought this, there are times when you think, maybe some of those atheists are right. Maybe this is all there is. I mean, it doesn't take very long when that thought crosses my mind. I'm like, Satan, be gone. Because I know that's not the case. I know that's not true. We have this instinctive belief that there's more. There has to be more. There's got to be more. There has to be more. I mean, even people who don't ever go to church or don't believe in anything at all, you'll still hear them talk about that there has to be something beyond this life, that there has to be some kind of life after death, whether we come back as some other form or we come back as something else or whatever. They believe that it has to go on and on and on. But let me tell you something that I'm certain of. Let me tell you something that I know beyond a shadow of a doubt. All of us in this room, every one of us here, is going to be alive somewhere forever.
Amen.
I know that to be true. We're all going to live somewhere forever. We're either going to be in the presence of God forever in heaven, or we're going to be in a place where God is absent, where there's nothing but continued suffering and anguish. And folks, I got to tell you, it's true. There is a heaven and there is a hell.
Amen.
Those places are real. And when we put our trust in Jesus Christ, we put in our reservation into heaven.
Amen.
We've made our reservation. Amen?
Amen.
And Jesus wants to take us to that place that he's prepared for us. And we've made our reservation. And the only way to get to heaven is by putting our trust in Jesus Christ. Because remember, Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. What? No one comes to the Father but by me. That's what Jesus said. Now, that may not be politically correct to say, but that doesn't matter because it's absolutely biblically correct to say.
Amen.
And I'll take biblical correctness over political correctness every day of the week. Amen?
Amen?
Well, the resurrection of Jesus Christ prepares us for death. It prepares us for a future hope. It prepares us for a future home. But then finally, letter D. You ready? Here we go. The resurrection of Christ prepares us for the present. It prepares us to live each day to its fullest. Because Christ is alive today, we have hope that carries us in our lives right now. There's an old adage that says, if you can get heaven straightened out, it'll help you get earth straightened out as well.
Yeah.
And I think that's true. If you don't know where you're going beyond this earth, then your time on this earth gets all messed up really quickly. As soon as you know that you're on your way to heaven and that Christ has forgiven your sins and you've accepted his gift, all of a sudden, the life doesn't get totally without pain or problems, but all of a sudden, life starts to make sense. Things start to make a little bit more sense. Hope for a better tomorrow is what sees us through 1,000 todays. Amen?
Yeah.
I mean, it does. Do you know that the hope of a nice weekend can see you through a very trying week? You ever thought about that? I'm looking forward to the weekend, boy. It can get you through. The hope of a wonderful holiday can see us through overwhelming busyness and stress of many weeks prior to it. Christmas, right?
Right?
But above all of that, the hope of heaven sees us through this life that we have today. It sees us all the way through. The ability to hope and believe drives us ever forward. And because we know that Jesus has triumphed over death and will triumph over evil in the end, just as Jesus triumphed over the devil on the cross, we know that we too have the sure hope of heaven, and that gives us the knowledge that our lives on this earth are not futile and they're not unimportant, but that God has a definite purpose for each of our lives, and that God has put eternity in our hearts. And that's why hope springs eternal in those who have their trust in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
We have a wonderful hope for the future. I don't know what's going to happen to America. I have no idea. I mean, scripturally, we have wondered, pastors, theologians have wondered for generations, ever since the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel became unlocked for us. And really, Revelation and Daniel, the book of Daniel, became unlocked as far as its meaning probably 75 years ago, maybe a little more than that, but not much more than that. And we really began to understand as a Christian culture, we've been theologians, and began to understand Daniel more fully. When technology began to take hold, we began to understand it even more so. And the book of Revelation. And we have all wondered ever since then why more about the United States isn't seen in the end times. Hal Lindsey, a whole host of other prophetic teachers and those who study prophecy their whole life, they say there's several possibilities, none of which are good. That either because America is such a godless nation that it's immaterial anyway. It doesn't matter anyway. Or because America has been taken out of the picture. Because America has been obliterated. It's gone. I don't know what's going to happen in America. I don't know. But that doesn't change my hope. And that doesn't change my desire to win as many people as I can to Jesus Christ, because I know the next great event to happen. Amen? Theology also tells us, prophecy also tells us, that the next great event that happens is the return of Jesus Christ. Amen? The rapture of the church. We're going to be with him. We're going to be with him. Amen?
Amen?
Are there going to be Christians who die before Christ returns? Well, absolutely. There have been for the last 2,000 years. Amen? And we may be among that number, but I think he's coming in this generation. I think he's coming. My hope is in the return of Christ. Amen? My hope is in a future with him. Amen?
Yeah.
But that's because of his resurrection. Did you know that each and every one of us has a God-shaped vacuum within our hearts? We do. We have a hole in our hearts, and until God is at home in that place that's designed only for him, we're just going to continually be on this trajectory of stress and a meaningless life. We're going to continue now to live in fear and anxiety over what's happening to our country and to our world, and we're going to live that way until we really reconcile ourselves to the reality of Jesus Christ and him living in our hearts. Amen? We have to do that. But when we accept Christ into our hearts and life, we acknowledge that what he said he would do, he did, and so that means that what he said he's going to do, he's going to do. Amen? When we accept that and believe in Christ, then that emptiness in our heart is filled with the presence of Jesus in a way that only a person who's experienced it can explain it. Amen?
Amen.
Has Jesus Christ filled that emptiness in your life? I trust he has. Everybody says,
amen. Amen.
I hope resurrection is more than just an extra long weekend for you, Easter holiday or whatever. I hope it's Easter is something that's truly filled with meaning for you. And the closer we get to the return of Christ, I hope you get filled with even more meaning with it. This morning, the first thing I did was I walked outside and I just lifted my hands to God and I just praised him and I thanked him and I worshiped him just under the heavens. And I said what John said, even so come Lord Jesus, we're ready anytime. It's my prayer that this year you're going to take to heart and think more seriously about what Easter really means. But we have to, in the meantime, do what God's called us to do.
Amen.
You know, Russell Kelfer served as an elder and a Bible teacher in his church in San Antonio, Texas, for more than 20 years. San Antonio, just stone's throw from here. Russell Kelfer. Maybe you recognize the name Kelfer, Kelfer Tire Company. Have you seen that? Kelfer Tires in San Antonio. If you drive down there, you're going to see some of the shops, Kelfer Tires. Look for them, okay? But his name's Russell Kelfer. Those are his shops or were his shops before he died. It's a family-owned business. But Russell Kelfer was also an imaginative writer who created stories from real life to illustrate eternal life. His most popular story is called Edith Easter. And here's the story. Let me read it to you. Edith Burns had been cared for by a young doctor for a long time, and she was a favorite of both her doctor and her staff. Edith Burns' conversations always centered around Jesus because for Edith Burns, her life centered around Jesus. She frequently used her doctor's waiting room as an evangelistic opportunity of sorts. She would throw out her opening line to whoever she was sitting next to. She would say, "Hello, I'm Edith Burns. Do you believe in Easter?" And more often than not, the Lord would have sent someone to sit next to Edith on a soft leather sofa there in that doctor's waiting room who needed to hear what she had to say. The receptionist referred to the waiting room as a delivery room where souls were often born again. And they experienced a real Easter. One day, 82-year-old Edith rushed into her doctor's office, private office, where he was preparing to deliver the results of her recent tests. He explained that the test showed that she had a disease that was inoperable and incurable, and that in the next few days and weeks, she would be going through a great deal of pain and suffering. And the doctor was in tears as he delivered this information to her. And Edith said to him, she looked at him, she said, my, doctor, I am surprised at you. I'm fixing to rush into the arms of my Jesus, see my dear husband again, worship with all my friends who beat me to heaven. I'm about to spend eternity in heaven doing the one thing I love most, celebrating Easter. And you've got a face so long that your chin is going to get run over by a grasshopper. And she said, I'm getting sent home at last, and you're afraid to give me my ticket. Shame on you, doctor. She then said, praise God, an eternal Easter. How long do I have to wait, doc? Well, 4 months later, Edith moved to room 424 Mercy Hospital, where she continued to bring her Easter message to many of the staff and visitors there. But there was one staff member who was determined not to get snagged by Edith's opening line about Easter. You know, her opening line was, hello, I'm Edith Burns. Do you believe in Easter? Her name was Phyllis Cross, and that was her name, and that was also her demeanor. Years as a head nurse in the ER and then a military unit, along with life experiences, had bruised her into the personification of her name. She was indeed a very cross person. Edith sensed that this hurting nurse was not yet ready for her Easter challenge, so she would just greet her cheerfully with, I love you, Phyllis, and God loves you. On another occasion, she would say, I love you, Phyllis, and I'm praying for you. Nurse Cross did everything she could to avoid the patient in room 424, but in late March, Edith was failing quickly. And one night, the night before Easter, as Nurse Cross was ending her shift, she felt uncontrollably drawn to that room. Edith greeted her through her intense pain with, good evening, Phyllis. I was expecting you. The nurse sat down at the edge of Edith's bed and asked her, Edith, how come you never asked me about Easter? So Edith squeezed Phyllis's hand and said, Phyllis, do you believe in Easter? The nurse replied, I've always celebrated Easter. I've always gone to church on Easter. I've always given my children Easter eggs. I've always celebrated Easter. Ah, but Phyllis, Edith asked with her blue eyes aglow, you celebrated Easter, but have you experienced Easter? Edith continued, Don't you see, Phyllis? The whole gospel is the gospel of Easter. Mm-hmm. Edith went on. She said, Jesus died for our sins, just as the scripture says. He died on the cross so that Phyllis Cross could have eternal life. Phyllis, do you know that you have eternal life? Do you know that Jesus Christ lives in your heart right now? Have you ever acknowledged to God that your sins nailed Jesus to that tree and asked him to forgive you and come into your life? Phyllis, you have celebrated Easter for years, but you can experience Easter for the first time in your life because Jesus is waiting to be resurrected in your heart in order to give you a taste of heaven here and now on your way there for all eternity, for you're going to celebrate Easter forevermore with me. When Phyllis returned to duty the next morning, she had a spring in her step, she had a smile on her face, an armful of Easter lilies for Edith, and Phyllis was a different person. She walked into room 424, and she looked at the lifeless body of Edith. Then she looked straight up to the heavens, and she yelled at the top of her voice, "Happy Easter, Edith! Happy Easter!" And as Phyllis Cross walked down the hallway to the nurses' lounge, she glanced at the faces of two new nurses, and she quietly said, "Hello, girls. I'm Phyllis Cross. May I ask you a question? Do you believe in Easter?" That's a true story. That's a question I guess we all need to be asked. Do you believe in Easter? I'm not asking, do you celebrate Easter? But do you believe in Easter? Because Easter is Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Have you experienced Christ in your heart? I hope you have. If you haven't, it's never too late. Amen?
Amen.
It's never too late to pray and to receive Christ, to confess, like she said, that my sins put Jesus on the cross, and God, I'm sorry, forgive me. Come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. And what he did by rising from the dead, he can do in your heart right now. And one day, he's going to do it to each of us physically as well. Amen?
Amen.
We just have to believe. We just have to believe. But let me add this. Let me just finish with this too. I think we all need to be like Edith Byrne. In some form, in some way, in some fashion, we need to be delivering the same question to people around us. Do you believe in Easter? Do you believe in heaven? Have you ever received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? We need to ask people. Amen? They need to be asked. They need to be confronted with that reality. I don't know how much time we've got left, but I tell you, there's still a lot of people who need to come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. Amen? We just got to get busy doing it somehow, some form, some fashion, witnessing in some way. And all God's people said?
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for the teachings of your word. Thank you for your resurrection, most of all. Thank you, Jesus, that you died for our sins, but that you rose from the dead and you're alive. And you're here even right now. You're in our midst through the power of your Holy Spirit. I pray that every one of us in this room know you as our personal Lord and Savior. And if we haven't, Lord, if there's somebody who hasn't accepted you, then I pray that they just settle that issue right now. If they'd like somebody to talk to, Lord, they can talk to me afterwards or whatever, Father. But, Lord, I just want to make sure we're all born again. And I pray that all of us have settled that issue. But, Lord, I pray also that you'll use us now. Help us, Lord, to be effective in these last days prior to your return and reaching as many other people as we can with the good news of Jesus Christ. Help us to be like Edith Burns. Not be bashful or backward or ashamed or anything like that, but just to ask people a simple question and be willing to just tell them what you've done for us. Lord, we love you. We thank you. Be with each of us, Lord. May we have a wonderful rest of this day as we celebrate your resurrection. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen
and amen. Well, may the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and fill you with all of his goodness. And may God give you the ability to witness like Edith Burns. All God's people said,
amen.
Amen. God bless you guys.